Yo, what's up everybody? It's me, T, and today I'm going to help you to start your new life in New Zealand, whether you're a backpacker or just resident seeker. I had nearly 1.5 years of experience living there, working there, busting my butt off. I would like to share my experience, my knowledge, so you're going to have the same, if not better, opportunities as you're hopefully going to visit that amazing country. So just to give you a quick brief introduction, what's up with New Zealand and why I'm so obsessed, you can tell it from my smile, right, with the country, is until now I have roughly 80 countries and so far I could only find two which could be my home on a long run. What I mean by this, New Zealand, well obviously New Zealand is one of them, New Zealand has some specific and unique features, such as, well, English language. To me, it's really important because it's either Spanish, Russian, or English, where I would like to live in my late 30s, 40s, whatever. And the people, just like, not necessarily in the UK, but more like in the States. Hey, what's up? Even when they, how you doing? How was your day? Are you busy today? Still gotta kick the clock for another 4 hours, or just like non-conversations, like small talks, you know. And even though it's not something you would like to have around the clock with your real friends, yet it makes a huge difference in your day when you queue for groceries, when you are waiting for your tickets or your numbers to be called in a bank, and somebody sitting next to you just starts and elevates such a small conversation. You kill time, you're not going to waste time listening the same bloody songs you've been listening for 3 years, and it's going to be a good like socialization, you know, and that will help you to pass time. And nature, guys, if you've seen Switzerland elsewhere than Switzerland, then that's New Zealand and maybe Kyrgyzstan, but I'm not going to talk about that today. New Zealand has such an amazing geographical location that it's not only the volcanoes, the glaciers, and the ice on its own what makes it beautiful, but also the forest. And you can basically see every single layers in the biosphere, and that makes it so unique, so colorful, that you can hardly ever see other places in the world. Also, because it's like a tiny country, like relatively like tiny, the size, I think it's like less than 100,000 square kilometers, North and South Island all together. And therefore, even though when you are in an urbanized area, it takes like less than 30 minutes drive to hit nature. And I mean hit nature. You can leave Auckland and get to the forest. You can leave Wellington and get to the semi-arid areas for the sand. It's just like spectacular. In other places you gotta drive for ages, but not necessarily days, but for hours at least, to have sight on mountains and natural beauty. The food is not really good because it was a British colony, and the English cuisine is not good either. And but that's enough for introduction. Now let's see first how you get there. Easy, you're going to fly because it's an island, right? And you don't need to worry about the transfer time whenever you want to fly. Why? Because it's so bloody far from everything that no matter what, you're going to deal with jet lag. And therefore my advice here would be is just to split into half if you're not in a hurry, because the flight tickets will not differ much, like less than $50. And if you're moving to New Zealand, I'm pretty sure that's not the $50 what was going to make the decision whether you stay in Kuala Lumpur or Dubai or Sydney or Singapore for a few days before you would fly towards New Zealand. So that's that, and just take the cheapest flight which has like 36 hours layover, you know, and that's going to be like two days total flight time. Take a few days and enjoy that one. Relax before you're going to move to New Zealand, because I can tell you one thing, New Zealand is so expensive compared to other countries, especially East European or Asian countries, Latin Americans, Africans as well, that you cannot just backpack or chill in a pool. Basically, what you gotta do is find a job ASAP in order to cover your expenses. Like, when I say expenses, let me give you a quick example. One loaf of bread, like 500 grams, will cost you like $2. Let's say a bar of chocolate is going to be $1.50. One quality beer in a pub will cost you $8, approximately $5 to $8. And that's quite steep, in my opinion, if you're asking me. Also, transportation, it's really steep taking the buses, even local transport, it's going to outweigh your pocket. Because, for example, from Christchurch downtown to airport, it cost me like $15, the local bus. I was like, what the fuck, you know, like, I haven't seen anything like this before. Other expenses, living expenses, I could mention. So groceries are quite steep, and wedges are really, really insanely overpriced. For one particular reason, because New Zealand, as I'm going to refer to it later on in many other ways as well, is a agricultural export-oriented economy. What that means is that it pushes its products to other countries, and therefore it needs to make sure that keeps the prices high, so controls the domestic market at some extent. Therefore, the trade business can make sure that there will be a massive surplus in production so they can afford maintaining and continuing the export business on its own. All right, now, I want to spend a few words on accommodation. You're going to follow basically the English protocol, which is pay week by week, right? And like I said, most likely I'm talking to backpackers, and I'm pretty sure backpackers will not rent a house on their own or apartment on their own. You're going to share it. So basically, each room has one or two beds. Most of the cases, that was my experience. And you get to decide whether you want to live with your friend or just live on your own. Obviously, if you want to live on your own, then you gotta pay more. And I would say it's going to vary between 150 to 300, 350 Kiwi dollars. I'm not sure if you have digged into that, but they use dollars over there. And it's pretty much in line with the Aussie dollars as well. And of course, you can pay more for your room, but why would you? I mean, most of the time, you're going to work or just enjoy the nature and get the hell out of the city. Therefore, I don't see any indications, any major reason why you should choose an overpriced room, an overpriced accommodation, when you're going to spend only a fraction of your time in that particular room. What's really important here is the legit contract, because I heard so many cases of people, backpackers getting fucked over, or their deposit is kept, or there are like a penalty imposed on them without any relevant reasons, you know, and that's a huge, huge bummer, because it's going to just like drag your spirit, drag your attitude, mood to keep on pushing. I had a good pal. He actually had problems with the bloody accommodation, because he just went around and he tried to decrease the prices, so he sort of subletted without any papers from someone else, and they made an oral or Facebook agreement, sort of, that if he's moving out then earlier than they agreed upon, then he needs to either fill the room and cover the expenses, or on his own pay upfront the remaining months. And you know, they even had to like deal with like court case or something like that. So it was a nasty happening to this dude, and I feel sorry for him. So just make sure that you don't really rush into any subletting agreement or even rental agreement without actually having thoroughly checked the whole contract and the whole agreement, to make sure that you are backed by those letters the same way as your landlord, all right? Now, let's move on to the job part. Most people actually go there to work. Work and travel, actually, it's more accurate. What I mean by that, New Zealand has realized something amazing, that it needs immigrants, but not on the long run, because they want to protect the domestic market and they want to control the population of the country. Therefore, what they did is that they launched this project called Work Holiday Scheme. By this, a certain number of nationalities are liable to apply for 6 to 1 year plus 1 year long-term visa scheme, when they can work and travel at the same time without any obligations. So it means that you get to have a visa, a work visa, but unlike a proper work visa, you are not bound to your employer. In a normal work visa situation, if you choose to quit or get laid off, then what's going to happen, you have approximately 30 days to either find a new employer and have all your documents sorted, which is fucked up difficult, or get the hell out of the country, which is a fucked up situation on its own, right? I mean, you went there not to just like go and leave after a few months, but to make a living and a solid standing over there. So by working holiday visa, you are able to work up to 3 months, but nobody really checks it, to be honest. And you get to decide whether you want to work afterwards or just travel. You don't even need to work for 1.5 year or half a year, depends on your nationality. It's all in the description on the New Zealand's government, by the way, it's really useful. And there you can find out whether you are liable to apply there, whether you can stay longer than 6 months or you can renew it or not. Like I said, it all depends on the nationality, because they had to determine whether that nationality is like more reliable than others or whatever. The longest, by the way, is the British one, because they can stay 1 plus 1 year as they hold a British passport. They gotta be under 30, and Hungarian is the only nationality who is able to apply to this visa up to age of 35. All the other nations, 30, I think. As you go there, most likely you cannot maintain your financial situation for a whole year or for the whole time you're staying there. Therefore, sooner or later, you're going to take some jobs, part-time, full-time, it's up to you. One or two, again, it's up to you. But you're definitely going to meet the difficulties and all the hurdles of finding a job in New Zealand. So therefore, here I am and I'm sharing you all the information. When to arrive? When is the best to find a job or look for a job? It's a good question, because so many of the backpackers fall into this pitfall where they think that they can arrive basically 24/7, any season of the year, any time, any day. And that's just a misconception. It's just like overseeing the facts that, like I mentioned before, New Zealand is strongly based on agriculture. Therefore, what they are seeking for is seasonal workers. I mean, you cannot harvest apples in January, can you? You cannot, Northern Hemisphere, and that's the punchline, one of the punchlines today. You cannot, let's say, milk cows in December because they all give birth to cubs in May, March, you know. Again, Northern Hemisphere, I still gotta swap my mind. So New Zealand, you don't need to be a geographer to remember, recall that it's on the Southern Hemisphere. Therefore, what's winter on the Northern Hemisphere, it's summer on the Southern one. So my advice, if you really want to get a job straight, you arrive to New Zealand, is to time your arrival roughly middle October and early December. In between these 1.5 months period, you get really, really good chances to be sorted and to find a decent job which will last till the end of the season, which sometimes even stretches all the way to middle May, if I remember right, and I do for sure. All right, so like I referred, and I have to emphasize over and over again that it's seasonal dependent. Therefore, to find a job during the winter time, it's really, really difficult. You must either have a trade, or you should have already proven yourself to your employer way before winter kicks in, so he knows that he can count on you around the clock, that you're giving 100%, and then you are just not fucking around, like, let's face it, most of the backpackers do, because the reason they are there, it's not to live there, it's not to get commitment. I mean, it's really hard to get committed to pruning. It's really hard to get committed to kiwi picking, or apple picking, or cherry picking, or you name it, you know, like sweeping dust or carrying debris or construction site. So, and we cannot blame them. We cannot blame ourselves, right? Because all we care is just like have a time of our lives, and I guarantee you that if you're willing to work for that short period of time, you're going to have the time of your life. Why? Because you need to work only for 3 months. I mean, most backpackers, they swap employers after 2 to 3 months. First of all, because of the regulations, most of them are concerned about this. And second of all, you give 100%, you cannot sustain it throughout the year, like, or for ages. You get demotivated, you get used to it, it gets boring, and it's fine. I mean, what happens in your office, right? Like, in the first few, maybe even first 6 months, will be all right. And you will find joy because there will be new, and the colleagues will be new, the stories will be new, but eventually it will sink and you find yourself at the bottom when you know everything by routine, everything is on autopilot and you don't need to think, you didn't need critical thinking, you just do tuck, 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 and therefore it gets boring and then you're just like, oh, fuck me, I gotta need another job, I'm not making an impact, and you name the reason why you would like to quit, but eventually you'll get to the point when it will take place in your mind. And what I want to emphasize here is, for that short of time, take as many hours as possible. Most of these jobs will not last long, seasonal jobs. So therefore, you gotta make sure that you make your budget, you cover your expenses, you create that financial surplus within a short period of time, within the season or within the week, month. You tell me how long you wanna work at one place. But then these employers will most likely give you the opportunity not to work 40 hours, but to work 24/7, basically. I mean this one, but most likely you can work like 8 to 10 hours each day, because agriculture does the harvest during the season throughout the week without actually days off, and you can go on rotations, like, let's say, take 2-3 days off throughout the week as you wish, or you just like bust your ass off in a short period of time and cash out as much as you can. Now I want to talk to you about the things I've done, because so far I was talking out of general experience, general knowledge. It's not really specific, and I'm here to give you personal experience, and that's why you're watching me, because I'm not going to share you others' opinion or YouTube or Google search, whatever. I'm giving you the shit which was experienced by myself and will be experienced in the future as well. So what I started, because I already had connections, luckily, as soon as I arrived to Christchurch via Malaysia, where I spent 1 week, referring to the solution, just take your time in between the two stops, is that I could work the day after I arrived. And it was amazing, because I went there basically nearly with empty pockets. I still had some savings, but I knew that I need to cash out from day one because winter is coming. I went there in February. It was quite late, but I was still lucky because I already made rapport with the employer, with the employees, because I happened to know somebody, and that helped me a lot. Without that, it could have been really difficult, I suppose, to find a job in February. Nevertheless, so I got there and it was sickling, agriculture. What I mean sickling is, you know the symbol of the Soviet flag, which consists of a hammer and a sickle. Now, the sickling is what I had to do because they were doing a research project. It's next to Christchurch, actually, a really legit company. The boss is just unreal. He cares about you big time, and he takes care of all the employees because he needs slaves. And I'm not joking, like, people who work 24/7, they don't bitch around, they don't whine, they don't grind. They just do the job morning to sunset and sickle, because again, this is agriculture, season based, and therefore the harvest season is 10 weeks. But during that 10 weeks, you have to sickle basically every single day, as many as you can. So as much as you can, so we can finish on time. And it's also weather dependent. You cannot sickle in rain. So therefore, he really appreciates when you adjust your days off to the weather, not to your heart or to your drinking habits, whatever. The wages, what I need to mention here, is pretty legit. Again, you get to pay the minimum wage, which is, or above minimum, but just about, which is like 15 kiwi dollars, roughly. And that will get you through, basically, because it's a decent money, and you have to pay taxes, but this one I'm not going to spend too much time. Let me tell you quickly why, because at the end of the year, you're going to file your tax report, and then you need to inform the taxation that you are not a resident over there, and you're not going to live there, you are a backpacker, and therefore they are going to refund. So, okay, $15 it is, and then you get to have like extra days, and he even gives you like extra hours, in a sense that you work till 5 o'clock, but you busted your ass off, all right, you get to write down 7 o'clock. And it, like, I haven't met anyone else in New Zealand or in my life who would do such thing. He was really treating us 100%. I had not a single word whatsoever complaining about him. Thanks, Gerald, by the way. I gotta give you a shout out here. I also mentioned the company below, so you can send an application whenever you have the guts to go to New Zealand and have the balls to work your ass off, because there will be no fucking around. If you fuck around, then you laid off, get the fuck out of here. And I don't blame him. he treats you perfect, you need to do the job perfect too. A win-win situation, everybody's happy and gets what's expected from the other half. So after this, I went to another company where they were dealing with vegetables actually, again, or well, still agriculture, and there we had to pick broccolis. Well, that's the nastiest fucking job. Or pick beetroots from conveyor belt, or pick potatoes, pumpkins, you name it. But guys, I tell you this, again, if you're just after the money, you don't care about days off or relaxing, then take this one, because that will give you 7 days if you like. Whether it's shit or not, yet they're going to load you because they have a huge demand for working hands. I couldn't really last long. I think I stayed there for 2 months or something like that. And it was more than enough. I did the broccoli picking and I also did the forklift driving. I gotta be honest with you here, because I had learned how to drive forklift before and they allowed me to do that. Nevertheless, I didn't have the license and that caused confusion, and then we get into not really a fight but rather an argument, and they were really nice because I, like I said, I busted my ass off, so they offered me long-term contract, what could have led to a residency, which is an amazing opportunity, but eventually I realized that this is not something what I want to do for the rest of my life, driving a fucking forklift like a gangster, you know, on a field. And pre-broker is whenever there is no forklift to be driven. And afterwards, I took some time off for traveling. And then as I came back, it was already like, I think, what was that? Like early May, something like that. And pruning season kicked in. Now, most of you are not familiar with the term to prune. And that means like cutting the hedges of the grapes, right? In a winery. When you do the harvest, you start making the wine, and then you gotta prepare for the next season, which is basically like cutting the hedges. It's a quite like complex job, but eventually after a few days it turns to be an autopilot, and then you just like do like even like closed eyes, because you know where you can find the good ones and which part of the cones you gotta keep, and on the whole plant needs to be spared or whatever. Nevertheless, it's a really good opportunity to work outdoor. That was an amazing plus to me. And to basically work unsupervised. What I mean by this, when you prune, you get a row which can vary from like 30 meters all the way to like 150 meters. Insane. But every row has one pruner, one backpacker like me, for example, or could be you too. That will not allow the supervisor or the manager or fuck knows who is in charge on site to be over above your shoulder all the time and just like Damocles war over your head, he would bitch 24/7, right? No, he basically works as well. Of course, if you have questions, you turn to him and you ask whatever. But long story short, you get to have the freedom. I had days when I didn't even talk a single word to him because I knew where I stopped, that's where I continued. And he didn't find any mistakes in my work, so he didn't feel like talking to me. And definitely I didn't feel like talking to him. So I was just listening audiobooks or language courses or just like normal music if I felt like. And I busted my ass off again from morning to sunset. What's good about pruning is that actually you don't need to take breaks. It's not mandatory. You take whenever you feel like. If you don't feel like eating, you don't eat. If you feel like eating for 5 minutes, you do that. Why? Because it's productivity based, not like hourly wage. There are some places where you are paid per hour, but I would say 95% of the companies, wineries, will pay you per plant. And that's good because that's a good motivation. They don't care how long you're taking your smoko or your lunch break. We are going to count at the end of the day how many plants you have done, and you get to pay based on that. Simple as that. And I love that. Why? Because, for example, I wasn't hungry that much. So I needed to spend only 15 minutes each 10 hours to rest. And within that 15 minutes, I drank my nutrition shake and I ate my porridge, and that would give me enough calories to push throughout the day, right? So we did that one for roughly about like 10 weeks. And how I got this job is funny, because most of the companies in wineries, in winery business, they are tightly linked and connected to a middleman. What I mean by it is there is a guy who's running a hostel in a big city around wineries, and he gives an advertisement on the internet. By the way, all those online websites are mentioned in the comment, So on those websites, online websites where you can search for jobs, he puts an advertisement, and I happen to know X number of wineries, and they are willing to hire backpackers. I can hook you up with jobs for long term, do pruning or wine, or whatever related. In exchange, all you need to do, and that thing actually must be done, to stay in the hostel. As soon as you leave my hostel, then you are going to be laid off because I'm connected to the guy and I make sure that you're not going to work further on it the moment you leave my hostel. Because what happens is that you're going to be packed like fucking sardines in a small room, like 4 to 6, even 8 of you guys, and then you smell each other's fucked up dirty clothes and the socks and the feet and it's not merciful at all. I really didn't enjoy at all doing this. But that was the way I could get into this winery thing. Anyways, my suggestion here is to again give 100% in the first 2 weeks while you stay in a hostel and you get to know the management and everything. Eventually, when you feel confident enough at work as well as with your interacting with your management, then you can just do sort of like a back channeling and then ask your manager, the company, hey, is it okay if I leave the hostel because I fucking hate the conditions, or you just make up whatever reason, whatever excuse you like, and then you just like move to a rental flat or rent a room, probably for the same price, but then you either share it only with your friend, or you get to live on your own even. So what we did is actually we teamed up with my friends and then we moved to and we rented out the whole apartment. I think fucking like 2, 3, 4, 5 of us together. It was amazing. And before that we lived 8 of us for the same price in one room. Now we had a fucking apartment, you know. There are tricks, but make sure that you make the rapport first. You give first and then you can ask, right? You're not going to get the permission like a random backpacker, hey, by the way, I want to move next day and you just started today. And no, they're gonna, okay, get the fuck out of here. Like, actually, we have 10 other backpackers lining up for such a job, staying already in that hostel. So don't over push it, I would say. Trust is really crucial in New Zealand at work, I would say. Based on my experience, you know, again, I can talk only out of my experience. I'm not going to shitting you around, like sharing others. Okay, so like I said, you are paid per plant, right? And that means you get to decide how far you are willing to push, and it's all up here, because it's not really hardly physical. Yeah, you need to stand all day long, so you need endurance, but you don't need like muscles, anything like this. So you just basically tuck, 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 and that will help you if you understand this and if you accept the fact that you gotta do monotone jobs throughout your stay in New Zealand, because most of the jobs will be like this. Most of the jobs will give you the salary what none of the East European countries or Asian or African, Latin American countries can provide you on the same level, right? Because obviously we're not talking about engineers or whatever, but I will be honest with you, I made more money than my parents all together. My friend from Latvia, he made way more money in 1 week than in 1 month as an engineer. And you know, like these are serious professions, yet New Zealand is just so much dependent on agriculture workers that you get the opportunity to work as much as you want. And about pruning, like I said, I get to the point when I made $1,000 a week simply because I was willing to work 7 days and 10 to 11 hours each day. And I just couldn't care. I couldn't care because I was physically fit, I had the endurance, I had the motivation, and I had the audiobooks to drift my mind from seeing it as a monotone, shitty, rubbish, garbage job to rather something what puts me ahead, what backs up my plans, what supports my near future desires, such as traveling or backpacking or launching my own business, you name it. So I strongly recommend if you ever get to work in New Zealand as a work holiday backpacker visa holder, then go for the winery. This is northern part of South Island, called Marlborough Wine Region. Again, from the links below in the description, you get to see where exactly this winery region is located. And I strongly, strongly, strongly recommend you to go and work there. If you don't mind working long hours, if you don't mind working on your own and being not necessarily isolated, but like sort of like separated, forced to do individual because one person, one line, one speed. And it's not about talking, it's not about fucking around, because if you do that, then you're going to either prune so few plans that you're not going to make enough money, or just the management will say that, okay, you don't work hard enough, get the fuck out of here. Again, we've got 10 other backpackers lining up for such a job, so spare the cones are not needed to talk pruning professional academic language, whatever. So what I did afterwards, like, most of the people do these like not skill required jobs. The only skill which is needed is being able to handle monotonity, the repetitiveness, right? There are a number, actually, just a tiny section of the backpackers arrived in New Zealand with a trade in the pockets, like carpenter, like bricklayer, like mason, like fuck knows what, you know, basically construction related. And they get to earn more. Like I said in the beginning, $15 roughly is paid per hour as a minimum wage. But by being a carpenter, you can make 25 per hour. And that's a huge, huge difference. Just multiply by 40, and we're talking about a weekly difference. Now multiply it by 160, we're talking about a monthly difference. You can feel what I'm talking about, I'm pretty sure. Now, what I did is after pruning season like finished, actually I went to Thailand to just chill because I was just like up here with the stress and with monotonity and fucking cones as well. So I said, no, okay, I need some time off from New Zealand as well as from the whole thing. So I went to New Zealand, went to Thailand for a month. Afterwards, I got back, it was like early spring, you know, there was no fucking jobs. I was searching for a job, I think for a week. And you know, it's nothing in Europe or in Asia or elsewhere. But in New Zealand, I found it like difficult. I was like, what the fuck is going on? Like, I always had a job. The day after I opened the browser to seek for one, to look for one, and now nothing's happening, you know. And then my travel mate, she told me that, hey, just look for Wellington, the big city, because she knew and I was well aware of it that what I really didn't want to do is working in a big city. I really wanted to stick to agriculture because I enjoy working outside, but I wanted to make sure that, and I wanted to make sure that I stick to this principle that I stay close to nature, which means that not really taking any opportunity in a big city on its own. I got desperate, and she also at the same time managed to convince me with a really good reasoning to check out what's up in Wellington, the capital of New Zealand, right? And I was like, all right, I can do that. And I found industrial alpinist, which is upsealer, which is using rope access, basically. You go to the top of the building, tie around it, and then you kind of clean the windows, paint the walls, flex or weld or paint, whatever. And then I found that job, and I was like, hey, I have this profession, I have this trade. What if I make a shot? And I made like a Aslakin inquiry with my CV, and of course, like modified in a number of ways. Nevertheless, I managed to pull it together, and I get the job. I happened to move to Wellington, and that actually ended up being a half year long commitment. And not at the same company, because eventually I worked for three, maybe four different upskilling companies. I enjoyed every single one of them. I had worse and better, but long story short, I really enjoyed, because I was not only paid $28 per hour. That's just fucking good money. Sometimes I had I think the best pay was like $32 per hour. That's insane, more than double than the minimum wage, you know. And when you work like 7 days, 10 hours straight, that's 70 times double of the minimum wage a week. And then you make the math, and at the end of the week, I was like, fucking hell, there's no bloody way that I could make anything like this in a month time in Hungary, using not even the same skills, but like, two, three levels better skill sets and curriculum. So I was really obsessed with this job, as well as I found joy within. So money was just secondary. The first one was like hanging on the rope. You already know from the videos that I'm really addicted to experience, to adrenaline, to extreme activities. And upskilling is one of them. Like when you grind all the sparks, are shooting out, and then you're hanging on 30 meters high. It's just like amazing experience. I love that one, and therefore this one, just like all the others in my life, except just a very few, that I managed to do something which where I don't give a shit whether it's Friday or Monday. In fact, I was sort of begging, even like demanding to be able to work on Saturdays, Sundays, because I just loved it. I didn't care about the days off because I didn't need the days off. I did something I loved and I was respected, appreciated. Therefore, I gave 100% every single day from morning till evening, Monday to Sunday. And that helped me to be motivated, to stay motivated, because like I said in the beginning, motivation is not constant. It's not like go up a bit and then it levels out. No, it goes up a bit. Actually, it starts up high and then it just shoots down straight up after, to me, it's 3 months. To others, it's 2 weeks, 2 years. Depends on the personality. To me, it's 3 months, therefore, I need to change sort of the country after 3 months. I need to change the people around me after 3 months, the common people. I need to change the jobs after 3 months. And I was happy that I found something that I could push Monday to Sunday. And this was the first one actually where I could maintain the motivation over 3 months as well. In fact, I left not because I got fed up with the profession or the companies I was working for, because there was time when I was working for three different abseiling companies at the same time. So for, let's say, every second day I was working for one company, every other second day I was working for another one, and weekends I worked for another one because of the schedule, and it worked just fine. The employees were happy, I was happy, money was flowing, but like I said, this is just secondary. However, if you aim for money in New Zealand, that would be my strong recommendation. Just get a goddamn certification. Even just the smallest one, just the online course, it doesn't matter. Even carpenting online, I don't know if it exists, but just to be able to tell your employer in New Zealand that, yeah, I have a trade, actually, I'm a carpenter, I'm an abseiler, I'm a welder, it doesn't matter. Whatever your cup of tea is, you do just a little bit of experience and then you over-exaggerate on your CV that, let's say, you were doing it for 1 year, and on site in a matter of days you're going to learn, you're going to master, not master, but like get a good experience set within the profession, and therefore you will be able to give a competent attitude, so it will allow you to make better money, and as you can see, the difference is not slight, it's actually major. Like, we are talking about at least $10 per hour difference if you have a trade and you work with that trade, or you just go there and pick fucking fruits or avocados or whatever. For geography, for traveling, I don't want to get into this too much because there are like thousands of movies on YouTube where you can see that what to see on the South Island, what to see on the North Island. So I don't really want to waste time as well as keep on mumbling about this. North is more urbanized, more city jobs. If you're into warehouse jobs, if you're into trade jobs, trade related jobs, then I would recommend you Northern Ireland. Especially two cities, Auckland and Wellington, obviously, but there are a number of major cities with a couple 10,000 of people inhabiting those, where you have good chance to find another trade related jobs. For South Island, if you're into trade but you want to stay close to nature, like really, really close, then Christchurch is your go. And there, I'm pretty sure if you have any construction related trade, you're going to get loaded, because like you know, the earthquake happened and now the city is full of debris, and now they're trying to rebuild it, reconstruct it. So there are like just thousands of constructions, like one on each other, like shrooms, the cranes are like shrooms. You'll be loaded in Christchurch as well if you don't. But Christchurch is a really cold city. I wouldn't live there, but that, again, that's my personal experience, personal opinion. To me, if I gotta pick one city, I would do Wellington, the capital. The next one would be Dunedin. That's down south. It's a university city, like full of like these like punk kids, and it's really like vivid, you know. It's like gangster city. On the contrary to North Island, the South Island is the nature. If you want to get involved in nature, if you want to enjoy more the outdoor activities, outdoor lifestyle, then definitely South Island. Like, bam, 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 bam. Like this you can find the mountains, like this you can find the natural wonders, like this you can find the activities you can do. So that would be the other punchline, North Island versus South Island, because to move all your stuff, to leave everything behind, it's not easy. Like I said, it's expensive to move in New Zealand, it's expensive to travel in New Zealand unless you do your own plans, unless you start hitchhiking. By the way, New Zealand with Iceland on the same place, the best country as far as hitchhiking goes. It's an island, everybody's isolated. At some extent, everybody is seeking for interaction, for love, for sharing, for caring, you know. Therefore, they're not really cunty as like in other East European countries or Asia, especially Asia, about hitchhikers. They don't want money, they just take you. They even ask you if you need a place to crash during the night. And that's really, really awesome experience when you just want to explore the country. Here and there, you bump into people who are more than happy to help you unconditionally. So guys, that was me sharing my opinion about finding jobs and doing something useful and something you may like and will load your pockets. New Zealand is an amazing place, like I mentioned already like dozens of times, and if not for the money, for the nature, for the experience, you should definitely go and visit there. Just sacrifice not necessarily 1.5 years, because you might have commitments, family, or office work, or whatever the fuck you're into and be involved right nowadays. Just go there for half a year or 3 months, you know. It's still an amazing experience. I cannot emphasize more. Finding a job is super easy. Again, check out the descriptions where I mentioned all the platforms where you can start seeking upfront, like let's say a month before you would get there, because these jobs are like on high rotation pace. So somebody's not going there the day after, 10 other will apply for the same position. So don't delude yourself. It's not like an engineering job that you can deal with the contract like half a year before you would actually start. No, it's like the longest we could do the transition was 1 month. But most of the cases, whenever I swapped employer or just took another job, it was like less than a week. So it's on a high frequency. Why? Because there are so many backpackers. There was an article in 2014, maybe 15, that throughout the summertime, there is a 50,000 extra demand shortage in agriculture sector as far as workers go. So therefore they try to fill up with backpackers. And in the beginning, that was one of the, such kind of motivation was actually the lead when the New Zealand government launched this work holiday scheme for dozens of nationalities. But nowadays it gets so popular because of the nature, the people, the culture, the money, the opportunities, that now it's pretty much in balance. Therefore, you have to be on site, you have to be talking to the person. Sometimes evens are not even working no more. So the closer you are to the fire, the warmer it gets, right? So, and that applies to this particular situation as well. Nevertheless, guys, you, with a little bit of me, are shaping society. Bye.